This is a really special moment, I would say extraordinary moment, for this year's Delphi Forum. Because we welcome the Prime Minister, Tony Blair, and I welcome him to Athens as well, and I thank you, sir, for joining us. He will discuss with Mr. George Peristeris very soon. Tony Blair has been one of the most charismatic world leaders of the last 30 years. The change he brought first to the Labour Party and then to Britain itself paved the way to the great period of optimism and extroversion of the United Kingdom. Cool Britannia became a synonym for uninterrupted growth, marked the resurgence of well-meaning patriotism, and the spurred celebration of cultural renaissance. We are lucky and honored, sir, to have you here today in a discussion with Mr. George Peristeris, one of the most prominent business leaders in this country. I give the floor to Ms. Rania Jima.
Okay, so good afternoon to everyone. It's a great honor for me being a part of this conversation regarding one of the greatest challenges that the planet will have to face through the next decades, that is the climate change. So are there any lessons learned from the COVID-19 pandemic which we can apply dealing with the climate change? Yes, there are. Many lessons, the two subjects are linked to each other and can be compared to each other. So it's a great honor to welcome to the Sixth Economic Forum Mr. Tony Blair. Mr. Blair has served the United Kingdom as a Prime Minister for more than 10 years. 1997-2007, he was the first Prime Minister to put this subject, this serious subject, to a very high level, to the G8 Summit in 2005. He still cooperates with leaders around the globe in order to find consensus in terms of international politics for the environment. And Mr. Blair is also the executive chairman of the Tony Blair Institute for the Global Change. It's also a great honor to welcome the president and CEO of YEC Terna, Mr. George Peristeris. Terna is one of the greatest groups present not only in Greece, but also in Central Europe, in the United States and the Middle East. For years, Terna leads the field of renewable energy sources and on the field of clean energy from the 90s. Throughout the period of the Greek crisis, Terna Group implemented investments that overcame 5 billion. Mr. Peristeris is also president of the LAS-RES. I would like to start with some thoughts of mine regarding the subject. We were discussing about it with Mr. Blair and Mr. Peristeris previously. What I understood throughout this COVID-19 pandemic is that when governments understand that they actually have to deal with something which is very crucial for their economies and for the lives of people, they can mobilize funds very quickly. They just need to understand the urgency of the problem. So if they decide, they can do that also for the climate crisis, because the private sector cannot move on itself. Let's take the example of the United States. The new Biden administration mobilized $1.9 trillion for the pandemic. They are not moving so fast for the climate. So I think we can start our conversation. So Mr. Blair, Mr. Peristeris, what kind of lessons can we draw from the pandemic and the way it has been managed? Do you think that the lessons can have a broader application to other major problems humanity faces, climate change, for example?
Yes, I think, you know, for governments, COVID-19's probably been the biggest logistical, organizational, practical challenge they've ever faced, that government has ever faced. And what's interesting is that the governments that have performed well have done better. You might think that's obvious, but it really has been a matter of the quality and capacity. Mm-hmm. And if you treat the subject of climate change with the same urgency, it should be possible to mobilize some of that same organizational capacity and strength. And so if you look at what we've actually done in COVID, We've gone from identifying a pandemic to getting vaccines to deal with it in a space of a year. In fact, the first vaccines were really developed within a couple of months of the pandemic beginning. We've managed to manufacture them at an unprecedented scale, do trials at an unprecedented scale. We've done testing of our population on a basis that's never been done before, and we've developed a whole lot of new tests. And if you think about what vaccination takes for a country to roll out vaccination across the country, I mean, if you look at the UK, it's been a huge logistical challenge, but it's one that we've met. So if it really matters, you can do it, is the lesson. And therefore, the question really, in respect to climate change, is that we know the answer is the acceleration of the science and technology. In the end, that's the only way you're going to beat it. And so the question is, how do you put in place the funding and the incentives and the framework that mean that we're developing those scientific and technological solutions to climate even faster? And again, you can more or less go through the climate change issue and identify what those challenges for science and technology are. So I think it's, you know, it seems almost too simple to say, well, we did it for COVID, you can do it for climate. But actually, I think a lot of the lessons are the same. And one final thing that I think, by way of opening, is also similar, is that it's only through global cooperation that we will win. So one of the things we're learning about this pandemic is that, you know, even if countries like Greece or the UK, European Union, USA, even if we get ourselves vaccinated, if the rest of the world doesn't, then the disease is still circulating. You can have different mutations.
Can we find this global consensus for the climate, Mr. Blair?
Yeah, this is what we've got to do. And I think this global consensus for the climate, I think, is potentially there. The COP26 summit that the UK will host at the end of this year will be an immensely important moment when the scale of the ambition has got to meet with the scale of the problem.
Okay. Mr. Peristeris, what was the greatest lesson that COVID-19 taught us in a very hard way, but at least which we can apply the next years in the climate change?
Okay. Not underestimating or understating the disaster of the COVID, I think the most serious lesson that humanity must take is that for something which is a pandemic and which is temporary, we have seen and have been terrified, and people have suffered, and people have died because of a pandemic which usually lasts 1, 2, 3 years, historically wise. So this should lead humanity to understand what a climate destruction will mean, because a climate change is a word, I believe, which was appropriate many years ago, or some years ago. From now on, the real word is climate destruction, because we're moving so slow that we could face climate destruction, not climate change. The key word is what the Prime Minister just said, urgency. Because the pandemic had an urgent character, everybody had the consensus. There was a lot of money deployed, a lot of laboratories, of companies, of scientists started working. On the other hand, the climate, at least as of today, does not seem as urgent, because we're talking about 2030, 2040, 2050, and all these things to the human nature are something quite long-term, mid-term, and definitely they are not affecting their lives of tomorrow and their employment and their standard of living of the next 2 years. So the real lesson is that if for the pandemic we see so much suffering, we should understand what the climate will bring, which will not be temporary, will not be faced by vaccination. So we must really try hard. I'm not a politician, so I cannot really give my opinion how this consensus can be obtained. The Prime Minister is much more experienced on this case, but there must be a global consensus, because the vaccination or the pandemic. No, the pandemic you can contain by closing the borders. Mm-hmm. The climate, you cannot close the borders. It will be for everybody.
That's true. And still they are also linked in the health view, because scientists say that this rising of the temperature and the floods, they will accelerate new pandemics, we'll face new pandemics. So, Mr. Blair, I think we all agree that we have to put governments to think how quickly they can act. What should they do? What sector should they mobilize? Is it simply a matter of clean energy or renewable sources, or does it get more complicated, involving multiple sectors? Can governments manage climate change without the private sector?
They certainly can't without the private sector, and yes, you need multiple different elements to it. And the point you make, Rania, about the escape of different pathogens mm-hmm. as a result of changes in biodiversity is very important, and I think pretty well established. So we've actually had a lot of near misses on pandemics in the last few years. And what we've got to think about is this pandemic has obviously been devastating. It could have been worse. You know, you could get a new virus that is as transmissible as coronavirus, but more deadly. So this is why, you know, dealing with the biodiversity aspect is really very important. So here's my take on the challenge. I mean, essentially, the problem is you're never going to defeat climate change if you tell people you can't consume. Mm-hmm. Right. And even if people in the West or parts of the West were to say, okay, we're not going to consume. We're not going to have motor cars or travel, or, you know, we're not going to use electricity in the same way. Even if we did this, there is a developing world where people, you know, they want the way of life that people in the Western developed countries have had, and they're going to want it, and they're going to demand it. And if you take, for example, my institute does a lot of work in Africa. Mm-hmm. Over the next 30 years, the population in Africa will double. There will be over 2 billion people on that continent. And they are going to want electricity. They're going to want infrastructure. They're going to want travel. They're going to want access to the modern world. And therefore, this is where it comes back to how you mobilize funds and the framework for the acceleration of the science and technology. And again, this is where you can learn a lesson from what we did in COVID, because we didn't. I mean, if you take the messenger RNA technology for the vaccines, you think how uncertain that was, and now it's there as a major part of the backbone of this effort. And probably, by the way, it will lead to a whole lot of new developments in tackling disease and heart disease, cancer. So on. Right. So this is where I think the thing that we've got to do is literally go through every single aspect of this, from fuel and aviation, carbon capture and storage, obviously the renewables that George and his company work on, incredibly important. And you've just got to see in every single sphere, mm-hmm. how do you incentivize the acceleration of the technology and then the implementation of it? Because, you know, George will be able to speak better than me to this, but, you know, renewable energy, wind and solar, I mean, it has become much, much more competitive in these last years. But that didn't happen just by chance. It happened because there was incentives and framework and funding put in place to accelerate the development of it. And so I think you've just got to do this in literally every single sphere of the problem. And, you know, you've then got to also help bring those new technologies to the developing world.
Mm-hmm. So Mr. Blair already introduced us a bit to also a more social approach of the subject. I would like to ask you, Mr. Peristeris, if clean energy is cheap energy, and will it only address problems of climate change, or can it also help fight energy poverty, especially in the developing world, essentially wherever it comes across it?
Well, you are absolutely right. It's not only tackling the climate issue, it's also bringing cheap and decentralized energy mm-hmm. to people who today do not have it, because renewable energy can be much, much more easily decentralized than fossil fuel produced energy, because it's by nature it can be decentralized. We only have to think that although only 10% of the whole global population lack access to electricity, 57% of the sub-Saharan population lack access to electricity. These are not figures of last year, it's figures of 4 years ago, but
big
they're
numbers.
Still...
They're very big numbers.
It's very impressive. So, renewable energy is clean, it's cheap, mm-hmm. and can be decentralized. So if we think what this availability of electricity, of energy, electricity especially, can do to these populations, who, as Mr. Blair said, are going to reach the double...
double the population.
Explosion. It's very important for social, for democratic, and for humanity reasons to spread out the renewable energy technology. And technology is the key factor because, as Mr. Blair said, 20 years ago, renewables was something like a hobby or like exotic things. Now it's the more competitive and cheap form of electricity. Why? Because mostly in the West governments endorsed it, helped to the financing, so the technology was evolving. It did not happen as quickly as the vaccination, but it happened over the years. Mm-hmm. So if there is a consensus on it, it will be done.
And I'm not so sure if it's so easy for everyone to link energy to democracy or political stability around the globe, but what Mr. Peristeris just said is exactly that, and you also mentioned it, Mr. Blair, that if we manage to do that, decentralize energy, cheaper energy for everyone, that means more democracy, more political stability for whole continents.
And, so, yes, and less geopolitical tensions.
Yes, that's true. So, since both of you assert that clean energy is cheap energy, do you think it will operate only in the economic dimension? We answer that. Or will it also bring about overdue social and political transformation? Can energy bring up political transformation, Mr. Blair?
Yeah, because so today more than ever before, because of the internet and because of digitalization, if you don't have access to electricity, you don't have access to the lifeblood, really, of the global economy. So for a lot of developing countries, if significant numbers of their people aren't able to use electricity, then they're not able to operate effectively. And that's why, you know, what we've got to do is look very specifically, for example, at, if you take again just Africa, so you've got several projects there, for example, around the use of solar power in the Sahel group of countries, which is a project supported by the Africa Development Bank. But how you mobilize the capital to use the enormous potential, solar potential of that part of the world in order to generate electricity for these countries, that's a challenge that is going intimately to connect to their politics. And with some of these countries which face problems of extremism, for example, you've got jihadi and extremist groups operating in these countries who actually prey on poor populations, get on the back of local grievances, cause trouble and disruption. So if you're bringing energy to those countries, you are also bringing political stability, you're bringing the ability to get educated, the ability to get healthcare. You know, so this is absolutely vital, and it's why you've got to tie all these different issues together. This is the importance of having global cooperation, because it's in our interest in Europe to stabilize the Sahel group of countries. And dealing with the climate issue and helping them develop is actually an important part of our own self-interest. Otherwise, the next wave of extremism and migration, by the way, will come from there. And you can see this already beginning to happen. So, you know, I think this is one of the things that happens sometimes in politics is that you get, you know, out of something that is a crisis, you can build real opportunities in different dimensions. And this is one example. And I think, you know, this is why the recent American leadership on this issue and the summit that President Biden hosted is incredibly important. This is whatever disagreements we have with China, mm-hmm. And we do have disagreements with China, but on this issue, we've got an absolute common interest. It cannot be done without China. We need China's involvement and participation. So, you know, it's the politics of this are both fascinating and require a degree of, you know, forward thinking and vision that is going to be absolutely essential to solving the problem.
So in order, Mr. Peristeres, for this to happen, that means to make the energy thing more political, to bring more justice, to bring more political stability, this has to reach every citizen. So how will the average citizen experience the clean energy revolution in the developed world? What difference will it make to the life of the average city dweller?
If we're talking about the Western world, for a person living in a big city, mm-hmm. Apart from the general climate issue, I don't think he will see a lot of a difference, apart from some chargers for electrical cars, etc. But for other parts of the world where there is really energy poverty, it will make complete change of their lives to the better. It will give access to education, to information. This gives access to better understanding of political issues, to democracy, mm-hmm. to social respect. It's a huge transformation. And it's not only energy or power, it's the whole way of life. I mean, the cyclical economy, mm-hmm. This will change definitely the way of life of everybody, but renewable energy is a part of the broader aspect of circular economy, which is very, very important. It's a bit more general, so not easily conveyed to everybody, but gradually it will.
Mm-hmm. So, Mr. Blair, sometimes the pressure for the governments comes from the citizens. In order for the citizens to put pressure on the governments, they need to understand how their lives, their cities can change. How our lives and our cities can change from this?
The changes, I think, will be quite dramatic. If you just take electric vehicles, which George is just mentioning, we will have electric vehicles that are driverless, probably in 10, 15 years. By the way, that is a revolution. Mm-hmm. In travel, but it's also got huge consequences for jobs and insurance and many other different aspects of working. So you require government to be closely involved because they're going to have to steer through this process mm-hmm. of change. I think people will, you know, for example, you need to replace a lot of domestic appliances. That, again, is going to be quite a big change. I think that the other thing is it's going to be necessary to look at new ways of creating energy. So you have blue hydrogen, green hydrogen. I think the carbon capture and storage would be really important. Batteries, obviously, this is absolutely vital. And so I think one of the things that is going to be important is to get the right relationship between government and the private sector. You know, the thing I learned about government is that it's great at providing a framework for others to work in, and it's mm-hmm. going to be necessary. So government's going to have to provide a framework, but government's not very good at picking technologies. So the best thing is for it to create the framework, to incentivize it, and then to ensure that, for example, around things like battery storage, mm-hmm. which, you know, we need answers on, that you've got a framework in place where you're mobilizing, it then becomes in people's interest to mobilize capital in order to go and seek solutions. And, you know, I think there will be all sorts of changes that the citizen notices in their lives, for sure. But if I had to pick one aspect of this that mm-hmm. troubles me, is that I think there is a gap between the time that we are now taking to develop these new technologies and the time that is required in order to get anywhere near the climate ambitions that the world has set itself. Mm-hmm. So if you look at where we are and where we need to be, there's a very substantial gap that we need to fill.
Okay, let's bring it to us. So Mr. Peristeris, given Greece's abundance of solar and wind potential, what are some other prerequisites that may turn these natural advantages into a practical benefit for the country? Can Greece participate in the clean energy revolution by becoming a regional energy hub?
First of all, I don't think you need to have a revolution. You need to have understanding and will. Mm-hmm. So I think there is a political will. It has been very it has been very clearly defined by the government and the Prime Minister himself. So the direction is definitely settled. As you said, Greece is quite rich in this kind of resources like wind and solar. One area which has not been addressed yet is offshore wind. There needs to be a regulation for that to start operating. Plus, as Mr. Blair said, the storage aspect, because for renewables, storage is a must. And in this case, I think once the framework is there, the market will choose what storage is better. For example, batteries, we know that they have a life cycle of 10 years. They need raw materials which are not abundant all over the world, while more trustworthy technologies like pump storage can be much more beneficial to local installations because they have a lot of local content. Mm-hmm. They have a life cycle of 100 years, and they have no environmental residuals as batteries have. Having said this, I think, to summarize, Greece has been given the direction by the government to go in this way, and I think it will go in this way. I'm quite optimistic.
Okay. So, Mr. Blair, where do you place Greece in this energy map?
Yeah, I think it's got a big role to play because, as George was saying, wind and solar can be developed substantially. And then, obviously, Greece is also looking at other relationships in the broader region, I mean, to the south. And I think, yeah, it's also one of the things I think that countries can do. So even a country the size of the UK, in the end, our actual contribution to the climate issue is going to be, you know, relative to China, India, America, small. But on the other hand, by showing how it can be done, you then, you know, that has its own benefit for other countries who can, because often with governments, they kind of think, okay, it would be nice to do, but can we really do it? Mm-hmm. And I think if countries like Greece and the UK can show how it can be done, this gives some impetus to other governments to follow suit. I mean, I think the other thing that will be really important is to make sure that we're using all the resources we can around development finance. You know, there's one of the problems that many developing countries have is that there are projects which they could develop, but they find it impossible because of the position of their country in the international financial system to get the capital to do. Now, some of those projects are very grand projects, like there's a project called the Inga Dam project in the Democratic Republic of Congo that could be the biggest hydroelectric project the world has ever seen. I mean, vast numbers of gigawatts of electricity. Now, maybe you can't do all of that, but there are major projects that you've got where with the right blend of development finance, you could get those going and make them investable, and at present time, they're not. And then you've got a whole lot of small For example, off-grid and mini-grid solutions in some developing countries where to lay the electricity grid just is not feasible. And those are very good for, say, renewable energy, for solar energy, small solar energy projects. So I think the other part of this that I would emphasize is the financing part. And this is where, you know, okay, the Americans are going to do now a big set of infrastructure projects, and a lot of that's going to be on renewables. That's great, and they can get the finance for that very easily. But I think we need to be looking at how different elements of the international financial institutions work together so that projects that could be investable are made investable. And I think this will be a big, big part of it, because otherwise you're going to find that even as I was saying earlier, even if some of the developed world moves very fast on this now, the developing world's going to find it tough.
So unfortunately for me, this conversation has to come to an end. It has been a great honor sharing our thoughts and our ideas. Gentlemen, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Mr. Prime Minister.
Thanks. Thank you. Thanks very much.